morning. Let me also begin by thanking Sesh for the invitation, particularly Professor Antonio Ribeiro, the Sesh community, and Inez and Alejandra for not just the wonderful invitation, but the care and concern that they have expressed and shown us over the last few days. It's always wonderful to come back to Sesh. Feel very much at home, and wonderful because when I look at all the names around, I come from Goa, and I find there are so many Goan names around. De Souza, Ribeiro, Pereira. It's much more comfortable than sitting with a Bhargava or a Vishwanathan. In my presentation today, I'm going to do something different. I'm not going to engage frontally with Boaventura's substantive arguments. I'm going to do a much more analytical exercise. And so in my presentation, there are four parts. I'm going to begin by locating Boaventura's work within a larger stream of ideas, very briefly. Then I will represent his ideas. I will try and see what I can derive from the vast corpus of his work. Then I will engage with some of these ideas. And hopefully I will conclude by seeing what these ideas represent as a resource for the future. I'm not the best person to do this. I'm sure this has been done within SAGE. I'm sure this has been done within the larger epistemic community that has emerged from SAGE. But since I've been asked, I think I'll try and live up to the challenge. It is a big challenge. And before I do that, let me congratulate SAGE on its 40 years. It's wonderful that an institution such as SAGE exists and has been able to not just survive the onslaught of conventional practices, but has been able to grow and reach distant shores and become available to discourse communities beyond Europe to other parts of the world. So congratulations on the celebration of 40 years. So let me begin by trying to locate Boaventura. I see Boaventura's work, which is enormous, as being part of a larger emancipatory literature, which is available to us. This is not a school. These are not people who have a common perspective, but they all contribute to the larger emancipatory project from which all of us can draw. So Franz Fanon is an obvious name, Henri Dussel is an obvious name, Rabindranath Tagore is an obvious name, Wallerstein is an obvious name, Chomsky is an obvious name, Césaire, Gugi from Kenya, Paulo Freire, Edward Said, and from India, my colleagues Ashish Nambi and Rajni Kothari. This is a very short list of a larger directory of names of people who have been part of the similar struggle that Boaventura represents, a struggle against dominant frameworks of understanding, a struggle against a hegemonic intellectual order. And all these ideas, and I say this because in my sort of, towards the fag end of my professional life, I find myself energized by engaging with these ideas. Too often have I been colonized by the dominant, and to find a vocabulary and to find a perspective and to find a body of concepts that this stream of ideas represents is truly liberating. So I see myself as a fellow traveler, and in today's presentation I have to move from being a fellow traveler to being a critical interlocutor. I see this body of ideas as producing a counter-discourse, as producing an alternative discourse. These are not synonyms. Not just a counter-discourse, but an alternative discourse, and perhaps a parallel discourse. And I want to use all three words, not as synonyms, but to invite you to look at the nuances between a counter, a parallel, and an alternative. Because in this process, Boaventura has very clearly gestured towards the production of this emancipatory knowledge from multiple sources, from intellectuals such as us, from activists from across the world who have so much to teach us, and from communities whose practices and perspectives are a resource from which we can draw ideas and perspectives. So a universe of discourses available, which is counter, which is alternative, which is parallel, and these are available because they've been produced by a range of sources. And this is what I think we can, with Boaventura, call the epistemology of the South. It needs to be recovered more robustly. The process has begun. South is a metaphor. South is a metaphor of those who've been excluded, those who've been invisibilized, those who've been oppressed. South is a metaphor for all that, but South is also a resource. And it is that resource which I think Boaventura sees himself as recovering through the range of his works. So that's the first part. I locate Boaventura's work within a larger emancipatory project of ideas, of practices, of perspectives. The second, the more challenging exercise, is now to represent Boaventura. I think I can begin by representing him in his own words. He has this wonderful phrase. He says, "I'm not a vanguard intellectual, I'm a rearguard intellectual." That's a wonderful phrase. So let's look at Boaventura as a rearguard intellectual, as somebody who stands at the back and tries to make sense of the world as it moves forward. And in this, he begins his work by making three seminal assumptions. Seminal assumptions, because we are so familiar with his work that we accept them because they come very early in the text. So they are there, and then we move on to dealing with the harder formulations that he makes. But these are seminal assumptions, not observations, they are assumptions, because through these assumptions can we understand the emancipatory project that is central to his work. Assumption number one: the understanding of the world far exceeds the Western understanding of the world. Far exceeds the Western. That means there are other understandings out there that must be not just noticed and acknowledged, but also recovered. And if I have to begin my epistemic exercise, if I have to begin writing my books, I can only begin it by making that acknowledgement, that there are other understandings out there which exceed the Western understanding of the world. I think this is a very important first statement. Second assumption, this we've heard over the last 2 days: you cannot have socio-economic justice unless you have cognitive justice. This is linked to the first. But what does cognitive justice require us to do? It's a wonderful phrase, but what does it require us to do? It requires us to give recognition and status to these other understandings of the world. Cognitive justice is such a powerful term that if it becomes part of our vocabulary, it is essentially subversive. And Boaventura says very clearly that unless we are committed to cognitive justice, all the rest of the talk about socio-economic justice will only submit to the hegemonic order. And the third assumption: the emancipatory transformation of the world may follow programs and scripts other than those developed by Western-centric critical theory. And such diversity must be acknowledged. So not just is it a perspective of the world, but it's an emancipatory script that is available to us. And it is all these three together, these three assumptions, that make up the corpus of Boaventura's work. Now, how do I describe this work? It is massive. But if I said that, I would be doing justice to it. It is monumental. Now I'm getting closer to describing it correctly. It is massive, it is monumental, and it is magisterial. And in my use of these three, massive, monumental, and magisterial, I am actually pointing out to you an increasing ascent of an emancipatory script. A massive body of work doesn't capture the emancipatory dimension of the work. Monumental does, but very mildly. But it is when it is magisterial, that means the statement that emerges from the work that Boal makes is a statement that is not diffident. It is a statement that is not not anxious and insecure when it is in comparison with the hegemonic statements of the world. So I see his work as covering a vast range, massive, monumental, and magisterial. And when you look at that body of work, and that's why I say I'm not competent to evaluate it, I find myself beginning with poetry, intellectual history, not history of ideas, intellectual history, law, political philosophy, legal philosophy, anthropology, history, religion, science, some economics, very little, but some economics, you see it there in a little bit on financial fascism. I wish there was more. Technology, epistemology, and the occasional glance at education. So there's a book on the university. So when we put all this body together, and as I said, I'm not the best person because I skipped over the chapter on Nicholas of Cusa because, you know, it required me to have a certain knowledge of Nicholas. But I see a forceful and a powerful challenge to the dominant hegemonic discourse. There is an alternative epistemology. There's an alternative reading of intellectual history. There's an alternative political theory. There's an alternative normative and ethical system that we can find. There's an alternative philosophy of science and a cultural theory. And in this body of alternative frames that Boaventura offers, you find concepts, you find thinkers, you find practices. Now let me move from describing this body of work to now narrowing it down and commenting on his style of presenting this. I want to begin by saying, and he probably may not agree with me, that there is anger in his writing. But it's a very interesting anger, and I've not been able to find the description of that anger. It's not an activist anger in a kind of declamation. Oh, the world is horrible. It's not. There is anger. It's not a measured anger. He's not trying to be polite. It's not declamation. And yet, consistently, there is an anger in the way he selects his themes, in his choice of metaphor, in his articulation of an argument, in the way in which he presents the work. That presentation is angry that the dominant presentation can be so arrogant. There is an anger against the arrogance of the dominant. So that's one. And that produces the second point in his style, that produces a certain confidence in his argumentative style. So when you read through his work, whether he's talking about the university and the Humboldtian University, or whether he's talking about a multicultural conception of human rights, he's not apologetic. He's not diffident. There is a confidence in the argumentative style. And then there is the language that is adopted. Third point about his style is there is a language, and this is where I have some difficulty with the language. Boaventura does a lot of inversions. So you get, for example, a phrase, the idea of force, and you're enjoying the phrase, the idea of force. Yes, the idea of force. So where is the logic leading to? And suddenly it becomes the force of an idea. So you're caught with all these inversions. So he's talking about the limits of representation, and you're thinking through what is the limits of representation. You're following the logic, and then what does it become? The representation of limits. So then you're jolted into a kind of logical break. So thinking through the limits of representation, it becomes a representation of limits. Or you get regulatory emancipation, and it's a powerful idea, and then suddenly it becomes emancipatory regulation. These are distinct ideas. And emancipatory regulation is very different from a regulation of emancipation. And the one I like best is illusion of reality becomes the reality of illusion. This is a style which he is, I hope it's not just playful language, but it's a style which is epistemically very provocative. You are forced to get out of your comfort zone, because if you have to read the next sentence, you have to work through illusion of reality and reality of illusion. It's one sentence. And you have, that has to make sense before you can move on. So it compels one to think. I've been a little unsure commenting on this style, whether I should say it is academic or political or academic political. Because even that decision to be academic or to be political is a political decision. And I think Boaventura combines the two purposes and projects extremely well. But it's difficult for a critical interlocutor to nail him into either being in the academic slot or being in the political slot. Now, so the work is monumental, it's magisterial, and therefore, how does one aggregate all this? How does one aggregate his work on the university, his work on movements, his work on multicultural human rights, not just multicultural human rights, his work on sociology of silence, the role of the World Social Forum, etc. I can only think that it's now the challenge is to present a big picture of Boaventura's work. He's a big picture thinker. He's a big picture thinker who also focuses on the detail. So therefore you get in his work concepts, ideas, perspectives, a vocabulary. So you get abyssal line. You think through that, it's a fantastic way to understand suppressed frameworks and hegemonic frameworks. You get the sociology of silence, you get the sociology of emergence, you get epistemicide, you get multicultural human rights, you get ecologies of knowledge through which you have to deal with this whole debate in the sociology and philosophy of science. You get cognitive extraction, you get globalization, and there isn't globalization seen, dominant globalization globalization from the other side. You get criminalization of the social protest. Small idea, but a powerful description, because in India, for example, at the moment, five social activists who have been working for the displaced tribals are facing the full power of the Indian state. They are in jail, and the court has not been able to stop the tyranny of the state. Criminalization of social protest. You get fascism, which is broken up into five forms: social apartheid fascism, contractual fascism, territorial fascism, insecurity fascism, and finance fascism. I like the finance bit particularly. And then you, of course, get these rhetorical flourishes. I have some disquiet on this, because the rhetorical flourish, I think, allows us to escape the logic of the argument. So alternative thinking of alternatives is a very difficult frame for me to try and understand. Because if I buy into that, then I don't have to work it out. I have a sort of intuitive sense that this is an alternative thinking of alternatives. Or a general theory on the impossibility of a general theory. We need to work with such concepts. So how do I, confronted by this massive body of work, represent Boaventura as a big picture theorist? I was struggling with this. And then I thought, maybe I should look for pictures, big, famous artistic works, to see how I can do this. And I'm no art historian, I'm no art critic, so I thought of three pictures that I will try and present, and see which one fits Boaventura best. He may not like it, but I thought, let me start with Rembrandt's. Master portrait. It's a group portrait. It belongs to a group portrait tradition of Night Watch. I think Boaventura would like the title. He's a Night Watch, Night Watchman. But I think this didn't work. It's too classical. It's too within the establishment. Even though there is an innovation in that, in the light that Rembrandt uses. In the shadow, there's a lot of innovation, there's a lot of detail, You can look at each of those characters and tell a story, and Boaventura's work is a bit like this grand picture, but I don't think it works. So I have, without consulting him, I've rejected it. Let me now take the second picture. This is a picture by one of India's great artists, M.F. Hussain, who's been persecuted, who belongs to the modernist... I've given the game away. who belongs to one of India's great artistic modernists, he's the modernist tradition. And this is a depiction of the great Indian epic. And it's said of this epic, the Mahabharata, that everything in life is in the epic. And if it's not in the epic, it's not there in life. So Hussain tells you the story of the narrator of the Mahabharata. You see the story of the birth of 100 Kauravas. You see in the picture right on the top, the great wise person who has the boon to decide when he will die, Bhishma. You see Arjuna's horses in a state of conflict. You see the merging of Ganga and Jamuna. You see so many details about the world. And this is a masterpiece. I'm sure Boa would like to see this as a representation, but this too I will have to reject. Because it's too obvious. The story is too obvious. You look at each picture, you can say, oh, that's Gandhari, and that is Vyasa, and that is Krishna, and that is, you know, and Hussain helps you. He even writes the name Krishna, and he'll write Mahabharata, and he'll write Ganga Jamuna. So you don't need too much to interpret. So this also will not work, even though it's from the global south. So the third picture. I think Boaventura's work is a bit like Guernica. I think it is Guernica that sums it up. Because this is the protest statement of our times. It's symbolic. First of all, the deliberate choice of color. It's in gray. It's deliberately gray. There's no, even the flower is gray. The severed hand. The two major symbols of the times, the horse and the bull, the light bulb. I think it is the body of work, if you have to represent it, I'm not being dramatic here when I say this. Sometimes, as academics, we only rely on language and abstractions, so I thought it was necessary to present a conceptual, a visual presentation of this work. I think Boaventura's work is like Guernica. So having been so nice, now let me be a little critical. I think the intellectual contribution of Boaventura is so expansive that it is easy to become a fellow traveler. Walk behind the framework. But I think that would be doing injustice to him. And I think therefore what we should be is not just a fellow traveler, but a critical interlocutor. And I want to do such a critical... I want to do a critical interlocution on two key ideas in his work. Not abyssal lines, not emergence of silences, not emergence of... not multicultural human rights, not globalization, which I really like his work on globalization, not his essay on financial fascism, though I would recommend that really should be the substance of his work, because it's that we are confronting today. Is one of the arguments on the others. This is the argument that has to be one, financial fascism. But on two ideas, one of which I sort of entered into yesterday, the day before, the ecologies of knowledge and the ideas of intercultural translation. These are two key elements of his emancipation project, and I feel they need to be engaged with critically, because in the little that I've read, and I may not have read everything, and I have not read everything, and I have not fully understood his positions, I find his politics is sometimes triumphing over his analytics. Take the ecology of knowledges. I think it's extremely important that he uses that idea to present the diversity of knowledge frameworks, which have been unjustly and unfairly excluded, which have validity and submit to validity protocols internal to themselves, which we must acknowledge. But Boaventura does not have a place, or at least I have not found it, and as I said, please pardon me if I'm misrepresenting him, for a conflict between different knowledge ecologies. So there's a statement in one of his works where he says, if we want to go to the moon, we use modern science, but if we want to preserve the Amazon, we use indigenous knowledge. And that seems like perfectly commonsensical. But what if the guy who wants to go to the science wants to preserve the Amazon? What do I do? What do I do when these knowledge ecologies are in conflict? And they are in conflict. I mean, assuming everything about the structure of extraction, about the extractive industries, about global economic, about all that we accept, I just want to negotiate two perspectives on a common aspect of the world. How do I navigate that conflict? And I don't find much help. Again, as I said, I must keep repeating this. I may not have read everything, so from the little that I've read, I find it necessary for Boa to take his argument on ecologies of knowledge and think through this question of a conflict. When I have illness, should I go for allopathy? Should I go for Ayurveda? Should I go for Tibetan medicine? Should I go for acupuncture? Each of them claims that they can attend to my illness. Some may say, okay, I can only do this much for that. But what if different people claim that they can attend to all these illnesses? Each of them is an ecology of knowledge, valid. How do I deal with the situation of when they are in conflict? I cannot rely on, well, those which are most broadly accepted, because you would say that is part of the hegemonic order. I cannot insist that the protocols of one are used to the protocols of the other, because you would say these are different knowledge protocols. So the Ayurvedic system takes the whole body, the allopathic system targets the illness. So I think this is something that we need to develop in terms of the ecologies of knowledge a little further. The second, intercultural translation. I believe, again, Boaventura's axis that he develops in intercultural translation is an important axis because it connects up with these three assumptions. So he looks, when he's presenting intercultural translation, for isomorphic concerns and underlying assumptions among cultures identifying similarities. Isomorphic concerns, as if once we identify them, there will be intercultural translation. Somewhere in the text, the word incommensibility appears, but it's not developed. I mean, what do I do with incommensibility between different perspectives and cultural systems? In India today, we are having a huge public battle on entrance to a temple. One group of people say, on gender justice, we should enter. Another group of people say, on tradition, we should not enter. Both are women. Both have to do with the group that has been excluded. How do I negotiate this? Because there seems to be, we seem to be in a situation of incomprehensibility, incommensibility. There is no point at which one can persuade the other that we can arrive at a common destination. Now, if Boaventura's argument on intercultural translation is a democratic project, then I support it 130%. It has to be a democratic project. These are excluded cosmologies. They must be allowed to present their case. We must engage with them. We must allow a conversation. It must be a horizontal, egalitarian space that is created. So if it's a democratic project, I can't be more in agreement with it. But if it's an epistemic project, then I have to express my anxiety at the point of incommensurate. And I see this, and I urge us to think about this. It's not just Boaventura's challenge, it's my challenge, it's everybody else's challenge. That we have to look at those points around multicultural societies where such conflicts will emerge, and some of these conflicts are incommensurable at the level of, at the epistemic level. There is no, I mean, small things can become huge conflicts. Secular human rights activists see circumcision as violence against the rights of children. Muslims and Jews see this as essential religious practice. What should be the position? The Supreme Court of Iceland ruled against the practice and went for, this is 3-4 months ago, not very long, ruled and went for banning circumcision. There was an international outcry, and so on. I can give you, in Switzerland, there was a case of two boys who refused to shake the hand of a teacher who was a lady because they said, in our religion, we are not allowed to touch a woman who is not in the family. The teacher was a woman. Switzerland says, this is our practice. We welcome each child into the classroom with a handshake. Every Dalit would be happy with this in India. Felt deeply offended. It had to go to the Supreme Court. So it had to be resolved by the courts. There are many cases, food, dress, religious practice, etc., where we are confronted by such situations of possible incommensurability. And we have to think through this when we are talking about intercultural translation. So having said that, how do I then see Boaventura's work? I'm reaching my conclusion. I think it's been a huge impact, and that impact is only beginning. There is an emergence of a research community that has emerged across the world. There's an emergence of a discourse community that has emerged across the world. Boaventura's work, Boaventura is a great ally of counter-hegemonic movements, of protest movements, not just an intellectual ally, but a political ally. Because he's provided us with concepts, with ideas, with perspectives. And therefore, I believe, and I want to state this in my final point, that we must see this project, and that is the task of this discourse community, which constitutes the fraternity of SEJ, to engage critically with this body of work. Not just to make that vocabulary a vocabulary that is widely shared, but to look for gaps in the argument so that when the counter to Boaventura's framework comes, we are ready for it. We are ready to deal with those who say incommensurability. We are ready to deal with the question of intercultural translation. There's a wonderful story I read the other day of a great translator who died, who recently died, it was an obituary in The Economist, a lady who translated many texts, but one of the texts she translated most was Asterix's Comics. And she has this wonderful description of her translation. She says, when the dog in Asterix, who's in Portuguese is Idifix, she translated it to English as dogmatics. Now just try and think of how she went, what kind of choices she had to make to render IDFix as dogmatics in English, into another cultural frame. And the summary assessment of her work was to say that the translator disappeared in all her work. When she finished her translation, she was not there. I think that is the power of intercultural translation. And so, Boa, thank you very much for your work. I mean, I think we can only be fellow travelers and occasional critical commentators. But yes, I think we join hands from my center, from the intellectual community in India, with SEJ, in taking this project forward. Thank you.